the journey itself is not easy, but moments like that make it so worth it because you feel seen. You're like, I'm no longer invisible. I am seen and I am needed somewhere.
Welcome to the Game of Her Own podcast, a podcast about women who work in sports. I'm your host, Jahaan Blake. After 15 years of working for three major league teams, including the Boston Red Sox, Los Angeles Dodgers, and the Chicago Cubs, I discovered the one thing I loved the most was helping women in sports shatter glass ceilings and take their seat at the table. I loved it so much that I made a business out of it. I have the honor of coaching high-performing women in the sports and entertainment industry and supporting them as they go after exactly what they want in their career. So if you are feeling tired of waiting on the sidelines, done being overlooked for promotions, and you're ready to pull ahead of the pack and take your career to the next level, girl, I'm here for it. I also created the Game of Her Own podcast to support you as well. We are here to share the stories of incredible women who work in sports and entertainment. These leaders and trailblazers will inspire you with their success and the lessons they've learned along the way to the top. Ladies, there is nothing like women empowering women. I am so honored you're here. All right, are you ready to dive into today's episode? Don't forget, this month is dedicated to women who work directly with the players. I'm talking about women whose jobs directly impact how the players perform. Last week, it was Hannah Huseman, mental skills coach for the Philadelphia Phillies. If you didn't get to hear her interview yet, make sure you go back after you listen to this one. You do not want to miss it. Today's guest is equally as impressive. Andrea Nunez is the strength and conditioning coach for the Los Angeles Angels. I am telling you right now, she will make you laugh, cry, and feel empowered as she shares her journey with you. Andrea shares how she nurtured the relationship that led to her job with the Angels for 4 years. She's going to tell you exactly how she did it. She tells you how she handles advice that she doesn't necessarily agree with, especially when it's coming from her coworkers. And she's going to talk to you about why she believes that accepting a low compensation offer is a huge mistake. All right, friends, let's do this. Andrea, welcome to the Game of Her Own podcast. I'm so glad you're here.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm excited.
Good. Okay. You have a really fun, I don't know if you consider it fun. I think it's fun job. But before we get into that, tell everybody when you first fell in love with sports.
I actually fell in love with sports before I even knew what sports were, just because I was thrown into it so young. I'm the youngest of three, and I'm the only girl in my family. So we started playing sports as soon as we could walk, you know, so it was t-ball and soccer and just anything that, you know, we could do at that age. And I just loved it. And I think I loved it because I was really good at it. So, you know, I got used to beating my brothers and, you know, being better than my older brother and stuff like that. So I really liked that feeling of being equal. You know, my parents did a good job of never telling me, oh, you can't do that because you're a girl, or no, just leave that for your brothers. And so I feel like that is huge because that allowed me to just pursue anything that I wanted in sports. And so once I found out I was pretty athletic, oh my God, I fell in love with it. I mean, it's just being out on the court and being able to show what you've worked so hard for. Mm-hmm. It's just an amazing feeling.
I love that story. Kudos to your parents. That's fantastic. So they just raised you like children, right? Like boys, girls, doesn't matter, your children. And it sounds like from your older brothers just trying to beat them all the time, that's where you developed your competitive drive.
Yes, 100%. The middle child, he's only 11 months older than I am. And then that, my older brother, he's 6 years older than I am. So it was definitely really equal as far as age goes with me and the middle child, Jesus. So it was always trying to beat them, always. And it's funny because sometimes we got too competitive and my dad's like, okay, you all need to relax, you know? And so I had a great role model in my oldest brother and a great competitor and the middle child. So it was really good to have both of those.
I love that. We could do a whole session on the older brother and probably the middle child. Like, I'd love to know like what his thought is, and you know what I mean, always having his sister, his sibling coming after him and trying to beat him. He probably viewed it, he had more to lose, you know, when he was younger, right? Because he was the older, he was older than you.
It's funny because I used to beat him up all the time because he was, you know, it's that brotherly love, you know, sibling love. And so it was always a battle of, you know, like, I'm stronger than you are. And all he would ever do was just, whenever he lost, he would go tell my mom. But if he ever won, he wouldn't say anything. And so it was hilarious. It was awesome. And so just having that was a really good, just bonding experience to be able to know, like, I can beat you, and I, you know, and I still have times where I lose. And so it's like, you learn failure quickly, especially once you have to deal with your mom because you hate your brother.
That's so funny. Wow. Are you guys still competitive?
Yes, 100%. But it's mostly a, like, family gatherings, like when we go out and play soccer, or like just something that is very outside of what we actually want in life. I feel like now it's not a competition. It's just a lot of support because we're all so, so different. We're all in different aspects of careers. And, you know, it's really now about support. And it's just being competitive whenever we get together, whether it's playing Uno, you know, whether it's playing soccer or anything like that. That's where the competition comes in. But as far as career goes, it's all about support now.
I love that. So tell us, speaking of careers, when did you realize you wanted to work in sports?
I think as soon as I figured out I couldn't go pro. As soon as I figured out, you know, college career is over, I'm not going pro, but I love sports, I want to be in it. That is the moment where I was like, I want to make this a career.
Tell everybody what you do now and who you do it for.
Yeah, I'm a strength and conditioning coach for the LA Angels.
Wow. Strength and conditioning coach for the LA Angels. So tell us, like, I mean, what is that like? Did you know? Okay, I have so many questions. When did you know that that's what you wanted to actually do? So you knew you wanted to work in sports as soon as you weren't turning pro. I think a lot of us can relate to that story. I realized I was not going to be Mia Hamm as much as I wanted to. So the next best thing was working in sports. But when did you realize that that's where you want to be in strength and conditioning?
Just growing up, I loved pushing my body to the limit. Where it was, we were doing sprints, where it was running the mile. Like, I always wanted to be the fastest. I always wanted to be the strongest. And in high school, because it's such a small high school, I happened to be one of the tallest girls. But once I got to college, that completely changed. I played volleyball, and I'm only 5'8". So, you know, I'm very short in the volleyball world, and I really needed something that was going to help me compete at the highest level that I could. And so backtracking to that, my brother got me introduced to weight training back maybe when I was 12, because my oldest brother played soccer in high school. And so he was always finding any type of weights, whether it was he was trying to bench or he was trying to squat, push-ups, whatever that might have been. And, you know, having that, I guess you can say, small representation of my brother doing that because he wanted to get better, I really got into that. But then when I really needed it, once I was in college, to be able to compete at the highest level, I really got into it and I loved it because I was able to compete with girls who were 6'2", 6'3", you know, it was, you could not tell the height difference when we were on the court. And I was really able to bring it and to be good because of the training that I was doing in the weight room. And I really wanted to do that for somebody else. And so once I got into school and I figured out, you know, I think this is what I want to do. I think it went from, I think this is what I want to do to, oh, I definitely want to do this through an internship. And it was an internship that I did in Houston and dynamic sports training. And it was amazing. It was the hardest summer of my life because the internship itself was unpaid, but I would do the internship from 5 a.m. to 2 o'clock. And then I would go to work from 4 to 10, 4 to 11 at a restaurant. And it was amazing. I would not trade that summer for anything because that's when I realized this is it. I want to do this for the rest of my life.
How old were you then?
I turned 21. So it was the transition between 20 and 21.
Wow. Okay. So you're in your early 20s, right? Just 21. And you said something that I loved. You said it was really hard, but it was really amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a sign of like you found what you wanted to do.
Yes, 100%. I was out of my comfort zone. I didn't know anybody. I went out there because my brother had gotten a job at the beginning of the year. I wanted to, get out of my comfort zone, and it paid off. It really did. I mean, it was so, so much fun.
What made you want to get out of your comfort zone?
I feel like nothing good grows in it. I don't think we grow from being comfortable all the time. I think for me, being comfortable is equivalent to being okay being mediocre for me. So the more I stay in my comfort zone, the more okay I'm going to be with just being good. And I'm not okay with that. I want to take the next step. I want to say, hey, what's next? How can I get better? So that's definitely the reason why.
We can just end right here. And just that was it. That's the podcast. It was really not if anything, if people who are listening, anything you take away from that, stepping out of your comfort zone. If you have big dreams, you have to step out of your comfort zone. I'm going to imagine that you were a little nervous and scared when you moved to Houston.
100%.
Even though your brother was there, right?
Yes, because I'm going to the job by myself. The only other thing that I had done, I always had somebody that I knew with me. And so just taking that step and being like, you know what, I'm just going to do it. Whatever happens, happens. It was very important for me to be able to be independent in that sense, because I'm an independent person, but I wanted to be independent in my career. And I think that opened up a lot of doors, because from that internship, it connects directly to why I'm not with the Angels.
Yes. Tell us how you made that journey from your internship and how long it took you to get that job with the Angels.
It took a long, long time. Let's say that. Let's say I planted the seed with that internship and I had to keep watering it and where it finally flourished. So I did the internship my third year in college, I believe. I graduated. I kept an amazing relationship with the owner of the company. He initially wanted me to work for him, but life happened and I wasn't able to. I ended up living in Hawaii for a couple of years, but I kept in touch with him, because you definitely want to keep those relationships. And that's what I'm talking about, watering that relationship. You planted the seed when you worked for them. You want to keep watering it. You want to keep reaching out. I definitely consider my mentor. And, he kept in touch with me, asking me what I was doing, how I was doing. And so for me, once I was out in Hawaii, he reached out and, asked me, hey, are you interested in working in a professional baseball team? And I was like, where do I sign? Because a lot of people mistaken strength and conditioning with being a personal trainer. And it's completely different, completely different. And so I did the personal training. Let's say I paid my dues in that sense, where I knew this is not it. This is not what I want to do. I want to work with athletes. And so when that opportunity came about, I was stoked.
Okay. So you nurtured that relationship, right? And you kept saying you watered it until it flourished. So talk about what that meant to you. How did you nurture? I think I hear a lot of women that I talk to are like, what do I do in the meantime? Like, I have a relationship. I met somebody. They're great. Professionally, we're talking here. I met someone. They're great. But I don't know, do I reach out to them again? How much do I call them? So take us through what that was like for you with that owner. Because this is a 3-year or 4-year, gap between when you worked for them and your internship until you got that call, correct?
Exactly. So for me, it started off very basic. Once I left the internship, I left it in August. And so when Thanksgiving came around, it was, hey, happy Thanksgiving. When Christmas came around, hey, Merry Christmas and whatnot. And so it was just those very basic messages until it was like, hey, would you recommend any books? Once I got into the book conversations with him, it was a lot of back and forth. Hey, I just read chapter 1. This is what I got out of it. Would you think that I gathered the right information? And so he was amazing in the fact that he was like, every single time that you read a chapter, summarize it, send it to me. And so it was, you know, I don't mind my own pace. You know, I read the chapter, summarized it, send it to them. Okay, this is what you missed. This is what you got right. And just being able to keep that going for a long time really helped. Just keeping them in touch as far as what's going on with you. Hey, I graduated. At that point, it became a decision that I had to make whether I wanted to pursue a master's or whether I just wanted to go out into the field. And so I talked to him about it. You know, he helped me as far as giving me his opinion. And so I think it's just very basic. Don't overthink it, especially when you know someone cares for you. Just having a conversation of like anything really, really helps.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more, because I think what you're saying is that you called or you emailed and you were asking questions. You were asking for help. And a lot of people get hung up on the fact that I'm just calling them for help and I'm not doing anything. And it's like, but people like to help, right? Like,
yes.
You won't know if they want to help you unless you ask. And if they don't respond, exactly, or they don't answer, then it's kind of, they have told you how they feel. If they keep responding, exactly, like this person, and they keep, you know, the book thing. I mean, it's like you had your own personal book club. That's amazing. Like, yeah. I love that. I love that. Right. Like, so you don't know where it's going to go. I don't recommend that people call somebody or email them and say, hey, what book would you recommend? And can we do, you know, can we have a book club? No, just see where it naturally goes. That's what I'm hearing you say is what you did.
Yes. And it's very, very simple, especially once you've already established your relationship with them. I established my relationship with him through the internship. I mean, when I was in the internship, I asked a lot of questions, many, many questions. And so a lot of people think that that might look as if, I don't know, for some reason, we're so afraid to ask questions because we think that if we ask the wrong question, that we're going to seem as if we lack credibility. But it's an internship. You're there to learn. You know, so I would ask questions. After I would ask the questions with the answers that I was given, I would study it furthermore and come back and have just a conversation about it. You know, so that, I think that helped me a lot, asking a ton of questions during the internship, because that showed him that I was interested in the education that he was providing for us. So I think once you do that, you establish that relationship that, hey, I care about what you're teaching me. It's a whole lot easier to go back after you've left and ask for more help or for guidance.
Yes, I think that's great stuff. I totally agree. Talk to us. So now you get the call and it's the job that you want. What was that process like?
This is where I'm going to give a lot more insight as to being a woman in sports. So I get the text message, if I would be interested. I said, of course, you know, send me over whatever application I have to do, whoever I need to talk to, send it over, I'll get it done. So I sent over my application, my resume, you know, but before I sent in my resume, I sent it to him. You know, I wanted to make sure it looked professional, it looked ready. Once he approved of it, then I went ahead and sent it in. I set up a interview. And the interview went unlike anything I thought. I mean, I've had plenty of interviews with just, you know, working at restaurants or whatever, you know, and it was never anything out of this world. With this interview, it blew my mind because it kind of gave me an insight of, you are the only female. That's when it hit. I had never realized that I was the only female until that happened. And so it was maybe a hour long interview, but half of it, they really wanted to know if I would be comfortable around, you know, an all male team. And so for me, it was weird because I was like, this is not the first time I'm a female. I've been a female, you know, for for all my life. So I'm like, yeah, I'm used to, you know, being around men. I'm not sure. Like, I wasn't prepared for those type of questions because it was something that for me, it was very straightforward. Mm-hmm. Yes, I worked around men. I mean, some of the teams that I coached are in Hawaii were male. You know, it was a men's volleyball team. So it was nothing that I wasn't used to. It was something that they weren't used to. And so I think within the interview, they wanted to prepare themselves for me. And so it was, you know, a really different interview from what I had. And it was questions like, if a guy comes up to you and he's disrespectful or whatever, could you tell him to fuck off? And I was like, yeah, I can do that with my whole life. Like,
you know? Yeah, you're like, next question, you got something hard?
Yes, exactly. And so for me, it was questions that I was like, why am I being asked these questions? But it became very apparent that the questions weren't really for me. They were for them to know whether they were prepared to have a woman on staff. And I didn't see it like that until, you know, now that I look back at the interview. Mm-hmm. But then finally, you know, I was able to give my philosophies and my experience and the way I process things, you know, that's when I was really able to let them know this is the job that I want and that I'm prepared for. After that interview, it was 2 weeks of not knowing a single thing. I honestly thought that was their way of just laying me down softly.
Then, you know, 2 weeks, that's it?
Whenever I finally got the phone call, I will never forget. It was December 31st. And I remember it because right after that, you know, it was New Year's Eve and I had like this New Year's party that I had to go to with good friends out in Hawaii. And the person who interviewed me, Ryan Croden, called me and, you know, he explained to me, you were going to offer you the job. You know, this is how much, take your time and, you know, thinking about it and whatnot. And really, it was a moment of reality that I never thought I would have, because this was it. Like my life was about to take a huge turn. As soon as I got done with the interview, I called my parents and, you know, the first people that I call, and my dad answered the phone and I'm crying and he's scared to death. He's like, why are you crying? I'm trying to figure it out. You know, I explained to him, you know, I got the job, I'm super happy, all the work paid off. For me, it was a sense of relief, because I don't think people understand that the journey itself is not easy. But moments like that make it so worth it, because you feel seen. You're like, I'm no longer invisible. I am seen and I am needed somewhere. And so for me, it was huge. It was an amazing, amazing feeling.
God,
the best way to explain
cry.
It. Yes.
I was like, this is so good. I'm going to cry. I feel like I'm right there. I can like see you talking to your dad on the phone. I obviously wasn't there. Wow. What an amazing moment. And I'm cold right now because I have the chills so bad. Like, what a great story. Hey, Jahaan here. I hope you're enjoying the interview. I'm sure you are thinking about your own career right now and how you can pull out in front of the pack to take your career to the next level. For 18 years, supporting women in sports has been my favorite part of my career, and I would love to support you. Whether it's joining my free Game of Her Own community or one of my one-on-one coaching programs, I am here for you. Send me a message at jblake@jahaanblake.com or DM me on Instagram @jahaanblake, and let's schedule a time to have a free session. I cannot wait to hear from you. All right, let's get back to why you're here. Okay, so now you get the job. You're in. How long have you been with the Angels?
This is my third year.
Your third year. Okay, so
yeah, going on to my fourth.
Tell us, like, how has it been? Like, if we were in a room full of women who wanted to do exactly what you do, tell us, like, how has it been? Like, what's some advice you would give us?
First off, it's been amazing. It's been so much fun. It's been a growing experience, a learning experience. It's been an eye-opening experience. It's been everything that I wanted with a little side of spice, I would say, because it hasn't been easy. Note it, okay? I didn't say it had been easy, but it's been so, so worth it. I've been able to learn so much about myself as a person, as a coach, as a woman in sports, as a minority woman in sports. It's been amazing. I mean, I think the toughest time would have been maybe like my first 2 months, because there's so many unwritten rules for women in sports. It's ridiculous. It's like, oh, you can't do this, you can't do that. Oh, don't do this, be careful with that. So you're tippy-toeing around what you can and can't do. And for me, it was really hard, because I was like, why? Like, why are there so many unwritten rules? I didn't understand, because it hadn't, you know, occurred to me the last time I worked with men. Like, I didn't have all those rules and I did just fine. So being in pro sports, it was a lot different. I think, again, a conversation that I had with my dad, I was like, I don't even know what I can do at this point because I have so many unwritten rules. And he said, look at here. You got to where you are because of who you are. So if you're going to fail, fail by being who you are, not by pretending to be or meeting what they want you to be. They hired you knowing this is who you are. So give that. Give them who you are. And if there's issues along the way, and if you fail, be okay with failing by being 100% you. And that really, I mean, that was something that I needed to hear, because after that, I was like, you know what? Screw this. He's right. I got to where I am because of who I am. Not by, you know, tippy-toeing around and being careful with this and being careful with that. And so for me, it would be never, ever, no matter who it's coming from, play down who you are. Because a lot of times I get told this all the time, and it's never by superiors. It's always by colleagues that I'm coming off too hot from the gate. And I'm just like, if you did the same thing, you would be praised. But because I'm a woman, I'm coming off too hot. Mm. And so I think taking those type of comments and just really not even paying attention to them is what's helped me, because it is who I am. I mean, if you watch me play sports, ooh, you would hate to play against me, okay? Because during a volleyball match, I let you know. I would let you know I am there.
And so for me, I don't say this often, but I am scared of you. I don't even play volleyball, and I'm just like, let me not be around her volleyball court anytime soon. You guys can't see her face, but she was just intense in the best way possible. Okay, keep going.
And so for me, you know, that's just who I am. And I think a huge part of that is it's my culture. I mean, in the Mexican culture, you don't sugarcoat anything. You're direct. You know, you're passionate. I mean, if you haven't seen Mexicans go to a soccer game, then, you know, that's what I'm talking about. And so for me, that's just, it is who I am. It's embedded in me. It's part of me. And so when I'm told, oh, you're coming too hot off the gate, you know, it's like, you know what? That's okay, because that's who I am. And so embracing those type of comments have really helped me, because they're describing me. Yes, I'm always coming off too hot because that is who I am. And fortunately, the right people have taken notice in that and have given me, you know, the opportunity to be in certain rooms and certain tables because of that. I think the biggest advice I would have for anybody who wants to do what I do is never downplay your value, ever.
Yes, that is fantastic advice. And take us through, okay, so someone's telling you you're coming off too hot and you're getting this advice and here you are trying to make it, right? So I'm imagining, I don't know when you got this, but it sounds like you got it more than once. The first time it happened, how did you handle it, right? Because I feel like you got to experience it sometimes. Sometimes you don't have the right reaction, right? Someone told me I was too arrogant or something along those lines. And I was like, what? Like, you know, right? So like, you have to learn sometimes how to handle feedback. So when you first heard that, how did you take it versus how you take it now? Does that make sense?
Yes, I was taken back. I actually don't even think I had anything to say to it. I took the criticism and I just, you know, I let it sink in, because for the most part, as I said, you know, like my passion a lot of times has gotten way more positive feedback unless you're an opponent than not. So I was very taken back because I related that to, oh, wait, are you not in my team? Are you not on the same team as I am? You're an opponent. You know, it was really hard for me to kind of take it in at the moment. And that's when, you know, I really talked to my dad about it. And he was like, that's who you are. I mean, that is who you are. And so looking back at it, you know, maybe the second or third time when I was told that, I would literally just say, oh, don't worry, you'll get used to it.
Yes, I love that.
So, you know, it was like, you'll be fine. Like, you'll get used to my coming off hot. Now it's just a sense of who cares? You know, if you want to have a further conversation about it, we can definitely sit down and I can explain to you, like, that's just who I am. You know, some people are very passive I unfortunately am not. I am very direct. I am very let's go, go, go. And so for me now, it's just a sense of they are affirming that I am still who I am. Mm-hmm. And for me, that's okay. And letting them know that, you know, they will get used to it. At the end of the day, this is what I offer and they can take it or leave it. And some people are going to leave it. And I've learned that that's okay too.
Yes, it is okay. Why would you worry about something you have no control over? And what I love about this is that you took in the feedback, but you didn't deal with it alone. So you went to your trusted, you know, source, and that for you is, you know, your dad. So you just told him and got that off your chest. And then it sounds like you got some fantastic advice from him. Like, I might want to call him. Like, he's giving you fantastic advice, but you didn't keep it in. And maybe you felt a little shame at the moment, but you didn't stay in that place. You figured out a way to get out of it. And I think those who are listening, when you get feedback that, and it's going to happen to you, right? Everyone's going to get feedback that shocks you. And especially when you don't know if you're supposed to, like, either. Sometimes it's not even from a boss. So you're like, am I supposed to listen to this person? They have more experience exactly. than me. They might have been in the game for, you know, 20 years. And here I am. And so they're telling me how I should be. So what should I listen? And what you did is fantastic. You just, let me sit with this for a minute. And yeah. then, wait, let me talk to somebody else and get some outside opinion. And then it also sounds like you reflected back on other feedback that you received and from other people. And it sounds like to me, if you're on your side, you people love when you're passionate and you're intense and you're direct. It's only people who are not on your team that don't like it. And so you exactly. made a decision, I'm going to be me. And that's it. And so you still have a job and sounds like to me, things are going well.
Yes. Yes. And I think that's important because, you know, I tell people all the time, like, you're not going to be everybody's cup of tea. And that's okay with me because I'm more like a shot of tequila. So it's like, you know, you either take it or you don't. And, you know, it's not going to be up to you to absolutely please to everybody. And I mean, I've learned that.
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like to me, you are dealing with being in a male dominated industry, especially where you are on the field, right? And you are just the way you adjust, because before you were just like, doesn't make a difference to me, men, women, we're all, you know, and then everybody on, you know, through the interview process, you realized there was a difference. And they were quite clear that they did not handle it the way you did. But how else has your experience been working in this male dominated industry?
I think I've had an amazing experience overall because I have people, you know, in power positions who really make me feel seen and heard. And, you know, that has absolutely nothing to do with who I am as far as them allowing me. That is them, right? That starts with them. Now, once they've realized who I am, what I can offer, you know, it makes it a whole lot easier. But I'm just blessed to have those type of people in leadership roles who I can go to. I've never sat in a room where I felt like I couldn't speak my mind with top of the top people in the room and whatnot. And so that's huge. I mean, if you're in a position where you feel like you cannot speak your mind or you're afraid, you're in the wrong room. You know, I really do believe that because for me, it's been amazing. I think, like I said, at the beginning, I was definitely more timid because of all the written rules that I was given. So I was like, what can I do? What can I not do? You know? And after I was like, you know what? This is it. Like, this is what I've always wanted to do. I got to take it all in and just go for it. And so in that sense, the experience has been so good because the people in leadership roles have been so open to my opinions and they're not always going to take action to an opinion or a suggestion, but the fact that they're listening and they're taking into consideration, you have a seat at the table and it's important. You got hired to give those opinions. And so to be in a room full of male leaders who allow that to happen for me has been great. It's definitely helped me grow in confidence as a person and as a coach.
What a great place to be. It sounds like it's a great organization. Have you been in other places right before this? And I know you're young, but which has nothing to do with your capability, but have you been in other places where it wasn't like that, where you were just like, this is, they don't want to listen to me for whatever reason. Like, and how have you dealt with that?
One time when I was working in the private sector, I was in that exact same position where I was like, why am I here? Like, I'm not, anything that I have to say, an opinion, it's not being taken into consideration. It's not even being listened to. And this was already after I had experience, you know, in pro baseball. So it was hard to realize the fact that, you know, no matter how much experience I have being in a new organization, especially in the private sector where nobody knows you, you start at zero pretty much. And my mistake in that whole situation, which honestly, I feel like that's what's, you know, started the attitude towards that organization, was that when they told me how much they were going to pay me, it was not enough. It definitely wasn't. And the second I said, okay, that's fine, like, I can work with that, that's when I told them I am not of value. And I know it shouldn't be your value tied to how much you're being paid, but that is how that happened. As soon as they told me, okay, we can offer you this much. And even when they said, we know it's not a lot, but this is what we can offer, the second I said yes to that pay, I screwed myself, because I told them I am not worthy of you listening to my opinion or my expertise. That was my mistake. You know, I feel like I set myself up for failure without even realizing it. And so that was a huge, huge learning experience, because once I got there and I was like, why isn't anybody listening to me? Like, I have a lot of great ideas. I have a lot of great experience. And then once I looked back at it, it was so obvious that I did that. I set the tone for how much I should be valued. It was very hard to deal with, especially being in a pro organization where you're at the table, you're present, your opinions are heard, and going back into the private sector and nobody's listening and you're looking around like, am I in the twilight zone? Like, what's going on, you know? But I set myself up for that. I, from the get-go, accepting that my amount of pay really, really hindered my possibilities of ever having some type of positive impact.
What would you do if you had to do that over again?
I wish I could. I would definitely say no. This is how much I'm looking for. And if it's not something that is feasible for you, I'm okay with walking away. And for me, because I'm always on to the next thing, I feel like that's a huge weakness of mine. Some people will call it a strength, and I think that it's not at this point, because if I'm always looking for the next thing, like, I can't be sitting down for too long, or I feel like, you know, like, I need to do something, you know? And so as I'm always looking for the next thing, I don't stop and analyze it completely. For me, that's been a huge weakness of mine. I don't analyze it completely. You know, and so as soon as I find a positive, I take it, instead of being like, okay, let's weigh out the pros and cons. No, as soon as I find something good, I go for it. And so for me, that's a huge weakness. And if I could go back, I would analyze the entire thing and realize that by me not asking for my worth turned exactly into them not listening to anything that I had to say.
Yes, that's great. And that's great advice. And this is why, you know, I love this podcast, is because people who are listening can take that and be like, okay, I'm not going to make that mistake. Hey, we're going to make mistakes along the way, but at least you have this little tip. Like, if I feel like I'm undervalued when they give me the offer, but I'm so excited about it, and I say yes, it may not work out well, because that means they don't value me. And even just having the conversation, right? It just talking about what that salary should be and why it isn't. Sometimes people will be like, okay, we can meet you and we'll get you what you want. Or they can explain to you why they can't, but they can talk about why, you know, why they value you. So I feel like there's a lot there that you can dig into in your offer and have a bigger, broader conversation, just not about the money, but what that money, not compensation, represents.
Yes.
That's good stuff. Okay. I feel like we talked about so much. This is so good. A lot happened in the past 40 minutes. Are you ready to have a little fun?
Yes.
I keep asking people that, and I feel like I build it up and people are like, wait, what? What are we doing? I got to stop building it up a little bit. Okay. So we're going to do rapid fire questions. First thing that comes to your mind, just tell us. Don't be nervous. Okay, favorite sports moment.
My favorite sports moment would definitely be when I got to go to the South versus North high school volleyball game. You know, we were competing against girls that are going D1, you know, top level schools and whatnot. And I don't tell you, being able to compete against girls with that type of skill was amazing. And so just to be able to get some points in and have that energy on the court. And I love to scream during the match. And so just, I'm telling you, nothing else matters whenever you get a block on somebody who's about 6 inches taller than you are. I just feel like those moments, I will never forget.
Yeah, still scared of you. Mm-hmm. Okay, good. what is something people always get wrong about you?
That I am an extrovert. That I'm very out there. And it's not the case at all. I'm very to myself. I love my alone time, just a couple of friends here and there. But everybody thinks that I'm super outgoing. Not the case.
Yes, I'm 100% with you. People get that wrong about me all the time. Okay, what is one food you cannot live without?
Anybody who knows me knows the upcoming answer. Tacos. Oh, I love tacos.
That sounds, I think I'm really hungry because I was like, what is she going to say? I'm so hungry. I want to hear this. Are you a morning or a night person?
It depends. Like for instance, right now, when the sun goes away at 5:30, oh no, morning. Yeah. But when the sun is out super late, I'm more of a night person. Just depends on the sun.
All right. Good answer. What's your favorite holiday?
Honestly, my favorite holiday, which I haven't been able to celebrate in the last couple of years, would be 16 de septiembre, which is the Mexican Independence Day. It's so much fun when it's celebrated in Mexico. Oh, it's amazing, and I love it.
Say that holiday again.
16 de septiembre.
Ooh, you know, I was going to try to say it, but I'm not going to embarrass myself. Okay, what job would you be absolutely horrible at?
Any desk job, because I cannot sit for longer than maybe an hour, hour and a half. Mm. That's it. I cannot be sitting down for 8 hours.
Yes. Okay. I can definitely see that. What product would you stockpile if you found out that they were no longer going to have it anymore?
Tacos. And they discontinue tacos, I would pile that in.
You know, freezers for days. Okay, what is your favorite app?
My favorite app, I think it would be Instagram. I think it's a good way to connect with people and to also kind of steer away from like what your job entails. You can definitely connect with people in the job. You can connect with other people. And it's just a good resource.
Okay. Who is your biggest inspiration in life?
Oh, I think I already know this answer. my dad. My dad and my mom. They gave up a lot to move us all from, you know, Mexico to the States. And anything and everything that I do will be thanks to their sacrifice. So definitely both of them.
Man, this is my first episode where I've almost like cried like 3 times. Okay. Let's see.
Me too.
As a child, what did you wish to become when you grew up?
A professional soccer player. So I think we connect in that aspect because Mexico is huge in soccer, right? Like Mexicans are all about soccer. They're super passionate about it. Mm-hmm. I was really good when I was younger. And then, you know, I would see that the biggest stars known worldwide who are Mexican were soccer players. I was like, I want to do that, you know, and it's just because that's what my people were doing, I guess. So yeah.
Yes. Soccer. Did you play at all?
Once volleyball came into the picture,
that was it. Volleyball was your calling. Okay. Last question. Yeah. Finish this sentence. The future of women working in sports is?
Limitless.
Oh, I like that one.
We're coming for it all.
Yes, we are. I love it. Okay, tell everybody, how can people get in touch with you if they wanted to talk to you?
Instagram or my email. My Instagram handle is excuses0_, and you can definitely include my email in the podcast notes.
Okay, good. We will include your email in the show notes. We will include your Instagram handle. We'll include also that place where you had your internship. Are they still up and running?
Yes, they are. Dynamic Sports Training in Houston, Texas. They're in San Antonio now and in Arizona. They're amazing.
Ooh, okay, good. We'll link to that in the show notes. Thank you so much for this time. This was so much fun.
Yes, thank you for having me. It was amazing.
So what did you think of this episode? Do you know another woman who works or is aspiring to work in sports? Would you do me a favor and share this with them? It would mean so much if together we could support and inspire other women on their journey. And let's stay connected. I love meeting and talking to new people. Follow me on Instagram at Jahaan Blake and join the free Game of Her Own community by visiting jahaanblake.com. I can't wait to meet you.